The regularly scheduled Monrovia City Council meeting this Tuesday, February 21st. And if you'd all please rise, we will have our invocation this evening from Kathleen Kramer, followed by our Pledge of Allegiance from Becky Shevlin.
I pray that we all be united in gratitude to God, the all good, that has brought us here together and is enabling those in their respective positions to report on their duties, present ideas and solutions that are essential to the activities and progress of the city of Monrovia. I pray that we acknowledge our unity with God, the intelligence that gives harmony to the universe, will also give harmony to every activity of our community and enable those present to be receptive of new ideas, to further ongoing projects to keep the city of Monrovia vital as it proceeds forward. I pray for our firemen and rescue workers that they be safe from danger, from smoke, flame, heat, accident, and injury, that they be bestowed with wisdom, intuition, and strength. I pray for those in our law enforcement that they be safe from harm and from having to harm another and be guided in their various duties. I pray for all our city employees for their welfare in supporting peace and progress in Monrovia. Bless us all with unity of heart, mind, motive, and aim. Amen.
Amen.
Will you please join me now in the pledge to our flag? Ready, begin.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay. On the roll call, Alice, if you would just make a note that the entire council is in attendance this evening. We had no closed session this evening, so there will be no report on that.
But Mr. Adams,
yes.
Before we continue, there was one quick addition to the agenda we were hoping to propose.
Yes.
I believe the time to make that presentation is now.
Oh,
and I believe
say, can you?
That the door is opening so we can make that presentation. I understand that it's somebody's birthday today, Mr. Adams. And I was thinking, maybe we...
The problem with my birthday is they had to get a special permit from the fire department. No, it's okay, Brad.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Tom. Happy birthday to you.
Is anybody taking bets?
Come on, go on
to the cap. You need my inhaler.
Would you like a cupcake for...
No, thank you. I'll take one. I'm not gonna.
So, no munching up here during the meeting.
Okay. Gotta have a birthday cupcake. Becky, would you like one?
Sure. There's also cookies in the lobby for anyone else that doesn't want a cupcake and wants to join in on some.
Yes, and please, if everybody wants to go out and grab a cookie. We can take a little brief break here, and you can join in the fun. You know, at this point, at my age, having a birthday today, I've been staring at cookies and cake all day long, every place I've gone. So my diet probably doesn't need any more, but if anyone would like to grab a cookie, please do. I'd love to have you join in the celebration. And we will move on now. Thank you, Mr. Chi, for that. PR1 is a recognition of Bill Marino for 36 years of service to the community. And Chase, you're going to give us a little report on that while you're walking up. You know, for years, this is almost the unnamed guy that took care of all of our graffiti.
Yeah.
And Bill, you've done such an amazing job on that. And the standard that you've set is what so many communities have missed on. And as I drive around to other towns and see graffiti, I keep thinking, they need a Bill Marino here. And so many towns don't have that, and they don't realize the importance of removing that as soon as it goes up. But Chase, the floor is yours.
Good evening, Mr. Adams, members of council. Tonight I have the privilege and honor of recognizing Bill Marino for 36 years of service to this community. For 36 years, he's provided exceptional graffiti removal and abatement services, as well as bus bench, bus shelter, maintenance and repairs. And he's done such a great job, as you said, that it for a long time we didn't even know who was doing it. It just kind of happened, and we didn't know that there was a graffiti problem. So with that, I congratulate you, Bill, on your 36 years of service, and thank you.
And Bill, we have a formal presentation we want to give you, but we're going to go through a couple things, then we'll come down and get a photo with you, if that's okay. Thank you so much. Next up, we have introduction of newly hired and newly promoted employees. Lauren Vasquez, our deputy city manager, please.
Thank you. Good evening, Mayor Adams and council members. Tonight, we're excited to present newly promoted employees and to welcome two new faces to the Monrovia team. But before I invite up our Director of Community Development to introduce our new building division manager, I'd like to share our excitement for this recently promoted individual. Hired in 2007, his tremendous work has exceeded our expectations time and time again. We're looking forward to being able to continue working with alongside this individual and to see him contribute his talents to the Monrovia community. With that, I'd like to invite up Craig Jimenez to introduce to you our new building division manager.
Good evening, Mayor and members of the City Council. I am very excited for many reasons, we've got a whole new building division pretty much tonight to introduce to you. Although Evan has been with the city for almost 10 years, he will be new in this role. And this is the building division manager also serves as the building official. And basically, is when it comes to building and building codes, and the buck stops with him. I mean, I can't even override the building official because he's basing his determinations on life and safety issues and looking at what the code allows. But I am just more than thrilled to be able to promote Evan into the management team of the Community Development Department. This last year, the Building Division did $103 million in valuation, which is the biggest year ever. And Evan was the sole inspector during that time, and in the last 14 months, we've had conducted over 4,000 building inspections. Evan did really the lion's share of those. So, you know, Evan will talk about our new inspectors, but we're actually having to replace him with two new ones. I'm just again real pleased. Evan is working on his master's degree in green building from the San Francisco Institute of Architecture. And when I asked him, so when are you going to be done? Any day now. His thesis is done, so he's just kind of in the final stages of that. He's also working on his building official certification, as well as his plans examiner and ADA certification from the ICC. So with that, I just want to welcome Evan to his new role as the building division manager.
Craig, thank you, Mr. Mayor, Council, and thank you, Oliver. And with that, I would like to introduce our two new inspectors, Patty and Joshua. Come on up. First, I'd like to introduce Shadi Sharmook. He's our new senior combination building inspector, and he comes to us from private consulting industry from Interest Builders. And he has eight different ICC certifications and worked in multiple cities doing everything from inspections to plan checks and everything in between. And he is currently working on four more ICC certifications and his civil engineering degree. And he's also an engineer in training. So we are in extremely good hands with Shadi. He has really hit the ground running in his first couple weeks on the job, and cannot be happier to have him on board. And our new combination inspector, Joshua Flores, is here with us tonight as well. And he has comes to us from private industry as a consult, from the consulting realm as well. He has 14 years of commercial inspection experience, 10 different ICC special inspection certifications, and he's currently working on ICC commercial building inspector certification and his construction management degree. So needless to say, we are in very good hands with our new staff here, and cannot be more excited to have them on board. One quick side note on Joshua. Everything I just said about him was kind of thrown out the window during a swearing-in ceremony. It was revealed that he's a Raider fan. So
I'm sorry. I just said what did you say he was?
Raider fan.
Raiders?
Yeah.
Are they still going to Las Vegas? Or are they going to Irwindale?
We're hoping Irwindale, but they're still looking at Vegas.
I think they're filling that hole now.
Yeah.
They are.
But anyway, we are all thankful for the opportunity and ready to do right by the city and continue to...
Well, other than the Raider part, we're so happy to have all three of you. Monrovia has a lot of great things happening right now, and we're going to look to all three of you to continue that greatness. And we're so happy to have you on board. If there's anything we can ever do to help any of you, please don't hesitate to ask. Thank you. Please give them a hand. And we'll talk football later.
And Mr. Adams, if I could just interject quickly, I just want to say that these individuals are definitely the best of the best. We put them through a vigorous recruitment process, and they came up on top. The inspector position is particularly difficult to recruit for, and we're very excited that we have them as part of our team. But just so that the community is aware, we do put them through a first day of training to understand what Monrovia is all about. So they learn about our mission. To serve Monrovia in a way that creates a premier quality of life. They learn about our organizational values of being humble, hungry, loyal, and smart. And they learn about our community and what it means to be a Monrovian and how to serve our community. So I just want to let you know that they are well prepared and are ready to work for you. So with that, thank you for the time.
Thank you, Lauren. Now we'll move on to number three, Pasadena Humane Society. This is a new, relatively new thing to Monrovia, and it's such an exciting part of our monthly meeting. Oliver Chee.
Thank you. And Mr. Adams, before we introduce Ms. Julie Bank, I just wanted to embarrass Evan again real quick as our new building division manager. Before we selected Evan, Craig didn't mention this part, but we put him through the pace. We weren't sure if we wanted to promote Evan or really go out and recruit, but as we got to talking with Evan, his goal really is to make Monrovia's building operation the absolute best building division in the entire world, actually. And to that end, Evan's actually been working on researching but trends and best practices of building operations from all over the world. And we're already looking at some best practices to implement that we could incorporate from all over the globe as it relates to how we be more effective in the building operations. So we're really excited to have Evan and also Shadi and Joshua come on board. Don't call Shoddy Shady. His name is Shoddy because we don't do shady building inspections in Monrovia. With that, I'd like to introduce Ms. Julie Bank. We have everyone, I think, remembers. Last month, we introduced Tiny Tim. We're so excited to be able to share. Tiny Tim has found a home. And tonight, Julie's going to introduce another furry friend that we hope we can help find a home for. Julie,
actually, I'm going to introduce two, even though I only have one with me. This is Limbo. And Limbo and his sister Coco were actually turned into the shelter when their person had to go into a nursing home. Aww. Limbo is 15 years old, and Coco is 10 years old. But do not let their age fool you. They have a lot of pep in their step. They're very active. They love to be around people. They are lap dogs, but they are also walking dogs.
Julie, I've been saying that all day long.
Yes, I know. These guys also qualify for a program that we have at the Pasadena Humane Society called Seniors for Seniors. So if you are over 60 and the dog is over or cat is over 5, then the adoption fees are completely free. So these are perfect for somebody who's really looking for just a special dog to call their own, for maybe a senior that she's pointing at somebody.
Somebody who's had some birthday.
Oh. I also want to say that, you know, it's an extremely sad situation for not only the person as well as the animal when a family gets displaced because a person can't take their pet with them. And the Pasadena Humane Society coming up in March is actually having a seminar on how to plan for animals in your will and how to plan for animals as you're getting older and what to do and how to make sure that the animals stay as part of your family. And if for some reason they need to not be, then you know what to do in the future. So we recommend that you visit the website at PasadenaHumane.org to not only learn more about that seminar, but to also learn more about these two. We are hoping that they get adopted together into the same home. And again, I think somebody's going to get some really special friends. This one likes to give a lot of kisses, and Coco up there likes to go for runs, believe it or not. Has been out on our mobile adoption unit multiple times and is a champion. So we hope that somebody out there sees them, is interested in adopting these two. Not only do we have programs for seniors, but we also have programs for children. We have kids camp. We have information sessions. And our next upcoming kids program is all about rabbits. So if there's anybody out there who likes rabbits, you can sign your kid up to learn more about that. But we thank you for the opportunity to come and introduce you to a wonderful pet that needs somebody. And hopefully somebody out there sees them and calls them their own.
Well, we appreciate you being here. The only exception, every time you mentioned the senior program, you kept looking at me.
I did not.
And Oliver, can we also again have the animals on our website and highlight the senior aspect of the program?
Absolutely. We'll make sure we do that.
And Julie, yeah, if we can come down and get
Please
a photo
do.
With you. And then, Bill, we're going to do you next up.
Here tonight that is not a senior that is interesting in the adoption process, I'll cover the fees.
For both of them.
Wow. Absolutely.
I know. What do you?
And just because Bill is retiring doesn't mean that we still don't have a great graffiti elimination program. So if you see any, call City Hall, let us know. We'll get right on it. Okay, now we'll move on to our student government representative, Martin. How's the high school doing?
It is doing very, very well. Thank you. ASB Club Cure and Ms. Kika have raised over $600 for the St. Baldrick's Foundation, out of her goal, which is $3,000. Currently, she has dyed her hair pink in awareness for that. And on Saturday, March 4th and 5th, MHS Band will be hosting their annual drumming regional competition. Monrovia High School's Drama Department spring musical, You're in Town, will premiere March 9th, 10th, and 11th at 7 p.m. in the Taylor Performing Arts Center. There will be no school on Monday, March 6th and 20th for in-service and staff development day. Environmental Club will host an e-waste on Saturday, March 11th, which will be located in the student parking lot. Monrovia High School's 8th grade showcase is on Tuesday, March 7th at 6:30 p.m. in the Event Center. We welcome all incoming students and families from Monrovia High School and outside the community to see all that Monrovia High School has to offer. Open house will be on Wednesday, March 15th from 6 to 9 p.m. at MHS. And last but not least, Renaissance will be hosting their annual Mr. Monrovia contest on Thursday, March 16th at 6:30 p.m. at Monrovia High School in the auditorium. Tickets are $5 at the door and can be purchased from any Renaissance student or Mr. Monrovia contestant, and in which I'm a Mr. Monrovia contestant as well.
All right.
Mm-hmm. Did you say a Mr. Monrovia contest?
Yep.
Larry?
No.
Is there an age limit?
I don't know.
Larry?
No.
You sure?
Sure.
All right. Martin, thank you so much.
You're welcome.
We appreciate you keeping us in the loop on that. Turn that off. Next up, we have our consent calendar. Entertain a motion on that.
Move approval.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any discussion? Any objection? Hearing none, that will be approved. We're now at public input. This is the portion of our agenda that the council sets aside for anyone to address the council on any item that is not on our current agenda. All we ask is that your name be given so Alice can transcribe that. And I see we have some speaker cards.
We do. We're starting with, is it Mariah Helm and Danielle Duran?
Good evening, Mayor and Council members. My name is Danielle Duran, and this is Mariah Helm. And we're a part of the drama department at Monrovia High School and would like to personally invite you guys to come see our spring production of You're in Town.
It may sound a little strange, but it's a very thought-provoking show that encourages our audience and spreads the message that we should all be thinking for ourselves. And we have some cards here with more information, as well as complimentary tickets for our council members.
And we'd like to wish Mr. Adams a happy birthday.
Thank you.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you very much.
Oliver, Danielle is one of your employees' daughter, Willie Duran.
Oh, really?
Thank you, Danielle.
Thank you both for coming down this evening very much.
Next, we have Gail Montgomery.
So, my name is Gail Montgomery, and I live in Monrovia, and I was going to... My thunder was taken. I was going to have us sing happy birthday to the mayor. I was going to have Oliver lead it and dance and get the high school kids, but we've done that one. So my second topic, happy birthday, mayor. My second topic has to do with gangs, but I already talked to Becky Shevlin over the course of the day, and I know that that's going to be addressed today. There is a significant concern. So let me take it to topic three. I would really appreciate it if our police department could do a better job in social media. They do fabulous things. Their plate is very full. But I can't tell you, after you guys go to bed and go do whatever you have to do, how many times we get questions of, why is there a helicopter, or what is that noise? And my romper room magic mirror just doesn't work like it used to. I don't, you know, I can't make up all those answers. I look to see on one scanner, and I look to see on another scanner, and I look, but I can never find answers on our page. So my suggestion is that we do like Azusa does, or do like Whittier does, although Whittier is a larger city. They actually do have a social media presence. Whether that comes from our officers or we take an explorer that is trained as to what you can and cannot say, and they could perhaps run that social media, or we take someone out of Citrus College that is interested in going into a career in social media and have them kind of tag along, possibly read the scanner. if they can get that media and information out there, we have a lot less unsettled citizens. Clearly, we're seeing it. We're getting that pushback as it relates to some of the gang issues. And I would rather get them the real answers than make up our own. So, thank you.
Good point, Gail. Thank you.
Corinne Crean.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. Happy birthday, Tom. I came tonight to announce publicly that the Chamber and the League of Women Voters will be doing a council candidate forum on March 6th, right here in the council chambers. And, pardon me, we have it all set up and every detail pretty much worked out, so we are looking forward to it. It'll go public on our Facebook, and we would appreciate everyone who follows the Monrovia Chamber Facebook page or the Shop in Monrovia page to maybe share that. To get that out there publicly. But just once again, I just came out tonight to let the public be aware that we are doing this on March 6th, 6 p.m., the Chamber and the League of Women Voters and the council candidates that we have. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Corinne.
Turn pages. Samantha Bloom.
Good evening. My name is Samantha Robinson Bloom. I'm a program representative with the Energy Network, and I'm here to invite you to tour two Monrovia homes that have had comprehensive energy upgrades. And we actually have a flyer that's going around right now. So these are free events. They are the Home Energy Tours Home Upgrade in Monrovia events held on Sunday, March 12th and Sunday, March 26th. They're open houses where you have an opportunity to walk through the home and see what types of improvements homeowners have made to save energy. Things like adding insulation, replacing their windows, getting a new water heater. You'll have a chance to talk to the homeowners, potentially talk to the contractor, and then also learn from the Energy Network about different resources that are out there. We actually implement the Energy Upgrade California Home Upgrade Rebate Program, which offers up to $3,000 back in rebates for doing energy efficiency improvements. So these events are sponsored by the Energy Network with generous support. Thank you from the City of Monrovia in promoting the events. You can find information on the events online at the City of Monrovia's website. You can also find information online at the Energy Network's website. And just as context, the Energy Network is actually administered by the County of Los Angeles, and these events are funded out of California utility ratepayer dollars. All right, so with that, we hope to see you at these events.
Thank you so much. I appreciate you bringing this down. I've been meaning to do it myself and just get caught up in too many other things, but thank you so much.
Pam Fitzpatrick.
Tonight I'm here representing my fellow Old Town merchant, Dominique Strivings at Three Beauty Bar. Fuzz Fest is back. Didn't Chris get his head shaved last year? Yes.
And he's promised to do it this year with a little extra flair. I'll let it be a surprise. Okay.
So this is the second annual Old Town Monrovia St. Baldrick's Day Fuzz Fest. Now, last year, we raised in town, our goal was $10,000. Last year, we amazingly raised $38,488. So this year, we want to beat LA. LA was the highest ranking of the Fuzz Fest. It was the combined, so this was a combined event, PD and fire department. In order to do that, we have to raise at least $100,000. Okay, that's our goal. This foundation, as you know, raises money to provide funds for childhood cancer research. So, I mean, who could not support that? We don't all have tons of money. There are ways for those with a lot of money to be sponsors, $2,000, $3,000. There are ways to, you know, do a $500 sponsorship. But what are we going to do in Old Town? Well, we're going to do something really cool. We're going to get merchants via these FuzzFest Credit for Cures vouchers, the whole page of them. But this is one voucher. And on the back, it has a business name, and then it says purchase total before tax. So what this is we get Old Town merchants to say, restaurants, retailers, other retailers, to say, you know what, on between March 1st and March 17th, the day of the event, if someone brings me a FuzzFest Credit for Cures voucher, I will donate 20% of that sale to St. Baldrick's. So then they bring me customers, I give them money. Such a deal, right? It's good. So I'm really excited about this. Dominique would be here tonight, but she had customers, so she couldn't be here. But I promised I would help her dethrone LA. So let's all get together and do that. There's no amount too small. Now, the deadline for a merchant to be on the list to be promoted as a site is next Tuesday, the 28th. And Dominic has got two kids and a business, and we're all trying to help make this work. The event is March 17th, same as last year, it's St. Patrick's Day. This year falls on a Friday night, and it's going to be, instead of being at T. Phillips as it was last year, it's going to be on Colorado during street fair between Rudy's and the Monrovian. At the very least, you go out and watch people donating their scalps to a good cause. It's fun. You could just support one of these people, like Chris Shevlin, and say, you know what, Chris, you're doing this. So for what little hair there is there, I'm going to donate X amount of money. We also need prizes and gift certificates for the raffles. So there are a lot of ways to participate. Just get involved. If you want more information, you go to their website, which is on here somewhere, which I can't find. Oh, it is. Here it is. stbaldricks.org/event/FuzzFest for the details, the stuff you can do. If you didn't write it down, you know where I am at the Cattywampus, and I will direct you to Three Beauty Bar, to the lady, Dominic Strivings, who knows everything. Okay? So are you in? I left you the green bracelets. Okay? There you go.
Thank you, Pam. Thank you.
Jan Bryson.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. I'm Janet Bryson, and I live on Grand Avenue. I've lived in town for about 15 years, and I'm thrilled that this is, well, I'm not thrilled that this is my first time here, but it's really great to be here. And I was prompted to come because you've changed the Saturday night. I typically come down Saturday nights to listen to Lance and Gary, and I know that has changed, and you're trying to do some new things. But a lot of us really enjoy the fact that they're there. They play all kinds of music that involves a lot of different age groups that love to dance, that love to sing with them. And their friend of mine, gathered signatures, and I think we gave you about 150 names of people that really enjoy that. One of the things that I love and why the reason I chose to move to Monrovia, I grew up in this area in Arcadia and Sierra Madre, is because of the real community feeling that's here in Monrovia, and Saturday nights downtown, hanging out in Meringue, listening to the entertainment. So I'd like to encourage you to think about bringing them back. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Appreciate you coming down.
I have no additional cards.
We have no other speaker cards. Is there anyone else? Steve, come on down. Thanks for coming.
Hi, thank you. Good evening, Monrovia City Council, and greetings to the people of Monrovia. It's been a long time since I've stepped up to this microphone, and I believe this is one of the most honored spots in this room. It's where the rubber meets the road. It's for the people, by the people, of the people. And so I take it very seriously. And most Americans, well, go back a step. For those Monrovians that maybe do not recall, because it's been so many days, months since I've been up here, a lot of people probably know me as a very vocal spokesman for the Foothills Wildlife Conservancy, as an advocate for our wilderness preserve, talking about the benefits of preserving wildlife habitat, benefits to all. And so it's been a while, and of course I used to grab the Monrovia Weekly and look for what information is there on the Wilderness Preserve. Is there anything I need to know? And this one caught my eye because it has the historic Santa Fe Depot on the front, completed in 1926. And I'm a student of history, a fan of history. And when you think about 1926, almost 100 years ago, an entirely different world we lived in. And the sort of gives us some perspective on our place in history when you think about history, when you know history. And to know and understand history, you obviously need the basics. I have a quote here from Thomas Jefferson: "An educated citizenry is a vital requisite for our survival as a free people." And the point of that education for people is using it, not just having it, not just having a credential. I have an education, you use it. Well, read the Monrovia Weekly. So as I picked this Monrovia Weekly up for my interest in history, and I paged through the entire publication to see what might be buried inside, and I got to page 21. This is the Feb 9, Feb 15 issue, and under Legals, Monrovia City Notice, there's a consolidated financial report for last year for the city of Monrovia, and this is, you know, hugely insightful information that I think everyone should look at. So I figured, so if this is something I overlook, then I encourage other Monrovians to take a look. And of course, it would be nice if it were, it's printed very small. You kind of need a magnifying glass to read it. But that's last year's financial report, very fine print. But it talks about, what do we got here? About $66 million in expenditures last year, et cetera. But coming back to my nexus for the importance of being here and speaking, petitioning the government and speaking to the people, it's, and again, something I take very seriously, but also having an understanding of our government, having an understanding of what our government is doing. I mean, I think as Americans, we take for granted the United States Constitution, and we take for granted our rights, and those rights are not free, and they're not exactly guaranteed. And one way to hang on to your rights is to use your education, participate in government, and that includes staying appraised of the financial picture. Winston Churchill said the best argument against democracy is a 5-minute conversation with the average voter. Well, it's thought-provoking, but if the average voter were to were to participate more in government, the average voter is going to know more. The average voter is then going to have a greater influence on his own life, her own life, and this country and our government. So again, this financial report in the Monrovia Weekly, while it's very valuable, it compelled me to go take a look at the city's website. I discovered some great things. And of course, looking for this document on the city's website, I discovered the Comprehensive Annual Financial Report, which was 219 pages long, so which will put anyone to sleep. And so even as a person experienced with numbers and accounting, I spent a lot of time paging through, looking for the most meaningful of information, and it's daunting to most people. So the more publications like this, the more you can use the Monrovia Weekly, which is everywhere around town free, to share numbers of the city with the people. I think that's a good thing. Anyway, it's a good start. I found it very interesting. And I suspect, and most people are not going to look at it because it's on the legal page, but, you know, the importance of it. So maybe in the future when the city publishes information, heck, go for the first page or go for a lead-in. Because if this incites other people like it does me to say I'd like more information and go looking for it, and of course looking at the city's website, I discovered Oliver Chee's, manager's update. Tremendously insightful piece of information that's there for everybody to look at. And most people, last thing they want to do, if they have some time to sit down, everybody's busy, they sit down in front of their computer, last thing you want to do is go to the City of Monrovia website. But it's a worthwhile venture, so I encourage everyone to do it. And that's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Steve. Appreciate you coming down.
Thanks.
We have no other speaker cards. Is there anyone else that would like to address the council on any item that is not on our agenda? Seeing and hearing none, we will close that. And Martin, I know you need to head off and get your homework done, so... thanks for coming down.
No, that's Mr. Monrovia. You got my vote.
We have no public hearings this evening, so we'll move on to reports of city manager and staff. And our council director is Mr. Chi.
Thank you, Mr. Adams. From our last council meeting, there were two items added to our city council directives update. They include a request that we schedule a study session to review possible regulations related to Prop 64 and the recreational use of marijuana. In addition, we were asked as part of our annual budgetary process to make sure we develop comparative statistics to be able to better gauge what's changing and happening from one year to the next, and that's been incorporated into our budget process for next year. Those are all the updates from our directives tracking sheet. What I was hoping, though, if Mr. Adams and the council would allow it, I was hoping to ask our police chief, Jim Hunt, to come up and give a quick update on some things that are circulating. We were made aware today of some concerns related to gang-related issues in Monrovia, or perceived gang-related issues in Monrovia. And while there are certainly public safety concerns that we're dealing with, we wanted to shed some light on exactly what the police department is actually seeing compared with what some of the reports that have been circulated around on Facebook and some of those other those social media mechanisms. So with that, Jim, maybe you can give everyone an update on exactly what it is that you and the police department have been dealing with of late.
Great. Thank you.
Thanks, Chief. We appreciate you being here.
City councilors, my privilege. And thanks, Gail, for talking about social media. We have been working towards that. It's challenging in that it requires staff, and they need to have gone through a background for us to be able to do some of that. So it would require some additional staff for us to accomplish that and be able to monitor it and do a good job at it. We had looked into contracting for that in the past, but that particular contracting service is unavailable. So we'll keep working towards that because I think that's a great suggestion. Talking about the gang issues, There's been a number of gang issues in our region, and as you know, gang issues are always regional. And when we had a lot of the gang violence back in 2000, 2008, it revolved around three gangs that are in our current region. And so recently, we've had some violence between two gangs. One of them is a blood gang in Pasadena, and the other one is a Crip gang that currently is primarily in the city of Duarte and the unincorporated areas of Duarte and Monrovia. We haven't seen any of the violence between those two gangs in the city of Monrovia, and that is primarily because of the efforts that we've taken on since 2007. We worked hard to prosecute all of the gang members that were committing that violence at that time. And then we've worked since that time now for 10 years with the MAP program, MAP leaders, neighborhood watch leaders, and wherever we identified a gang member that was committing criminal acts in a neighborhood, we worked with the neighbors to put pressure on the landlords and ask them to evict. And we've been doing that now for 10 years. And what that's resulted in, where we used to have over 300 gang members in the city of Monrovia, we have less than 10 now. And that's just by hard work by everyone in our community working together. And as you all know, we also put together a gang injunction back in 2008, and it became a permanent injunction in 2010. And I want to thank the city council and also the county of Los Angeles who partnered with us, because it impacts Monrovia and it impacts the unincorporated areas. And it's been a great tool for our staff to have an impact on gang violence in our community. And we've used that tool. And what we found is that when gang members' families are evicted, they don't move back to Monrovia, because with that tool, it puts them in a position where they don't want to be here, because there's many restrictions on them through the civil injunction. So for us, in this current period of gang violence, we haven't had any of the activity between the Duroc Crips and the Pasadena Denver Lane Bloods that's going back and forth, because we have very few gang members living in our city. That doesn't mean that it can't occur here, because obviously we're between those communities and gang members travel back and forth. So what we've seen, though, recently, and what you've seen in the city manager's report and in our neighborhood watch report, is we had a shooting recently down on Los Angeles Street. And what that was a Hispanic gang member that had recently gotten out of jail. And they came back and shot at an innocent party that's not a gang member. And fortunately, they did not hit them. And for us, our officers responded quickly, did a phenomenal job. Got both the suspects in custody and located a driver that was waiting for them. And then they literally worked around the clock all night long and into the next day searching for the handgun. And they found it in the alley in the arm of a dumpster where the forklift goes in. So just great work by our staff, great work by our detectives to build a case. And we believe that this gang member will be looking at hopefully a long period of time. And that's the other story I want to talk about with this, is that this gang member was out of Monrovia and living in another area. He went to a party in Ontario where there was a shooting and a stabbing, and he was arrested for attempt murder. And this was in 2015. So he went to court, and in the process of that case, he pled down to assault with a deadly weapon and was convicted. He got time served in the county jail of 6 months, and then he did 3 months in a state prison. He did a total of 9 months for an attempted murder. And this is what we're looking at in our state. Every day served, they get a good day of time off. Prop 57, which the voters of California passed recently, just makes it that much easier for them to get out quickly. And what we see is these folks get out, they're not rehabilitated, and they're coming back and committing crimes in our community and victimizing our citizens. And so that was just one instance. And if you look just this week, you know, the tragic shooting of Officer Keith Boyer in Whittier, and then Officer Patrick Hazel that was wounded as well. The suspect in that case was arrested in 2010, 4 years for robbery, out. As soon as he gets out, he gets 2 years for GTA, and he gets released early per April.
Chief, 2 years for what?
For, I'm sorry, Grand Theft Auto. Yes,
thank you.
I'm using an acronym. Thank you for correcting me. And he was released early per Assembly Bill 109 on local supervision to LA County Probation. And this is the individual that killed a family member and then turned around and shot two officers, killing one. It's just another example of how it's just a revolving door with all of these things in our jails. Covina, just this week, two women shot and killed, and a two-year-old child shot in the back. The suspect in that case is on parole for drug violations. He was fitted with an ankle monitor, which is another form that the state is using to get them out of the custody system, and they think that they're monitored, but it doesn't keep them from committing crimes. And we've had several individuals that had ankle bracelets on that we've arrested in this last year. He had been in custody before for burglary and resisting arrest, possession of a gun by a felon, possession for drugs for sales, and also assault with a deadly weapon. So his charge that he was in there on was a property crime, burglary. So he gets, you know, it's they don't consider that as serious. But if you look at his criminal history, he's obviously a violent felon with guns. He fled from Covina PD on one occasion after a burglary. They also had to do a SWAT call out to his home where he was found hiding in an attic. And it's just more stories that we're seeing that's going to be the result of Assembly Bill 109, Prop 47, Prop 57, and the increased crime that we're seeing. I'm thankful that our officers have been doing some terrific work. We've gotten a number of folks in custody recently that are all these types of individuals on property crimes that are burglarizing our businesses, burglarizing our homes. Many of them, probably two-thirds of the ones we've arrested in the last month, were gang members out of Long Beach. And so it's just challenging for law enforcement right now. It's sad because we knew this would be coming down the pipe, and it's just a challenging situation. On the gang issues, I can tell you that Monrovia has had a tremendous impact, which is why we're not seeing, you know, the types of shootings that we're seeing in our neighboring communities, because the gang members just don't live here anymore. And once again, that doesn't mean that we're not going to have those types of crimes, because they drive through our communities. And some of them, like in this case with the shooting we just had, is someone that moved back into our community. And in the short time that he's here, he's already committed a crime. So, and with that, if you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
Can I ask, Chief, there was some talk about the possibility, or that some of our programs, our gang programs, had been discontinued because of budget constraints. Could you address that?
No, none of them have been discontinued because of budget constraints. We did it in 2000, 2008, when all the shootings were occurring. We put together a regional task force that included the Sheriff's Department, Highway Patrol. We had 18 cities come in and patrol our city, and that was used for that immediate time frame to quell the violence while our investigators would work through the cases and try and get folks identified and in custody. So that lasted for about 6 months to a year, and had a profound effect in stopping the violence. And then since then, we've just continued to work to remove gang members from our community. And then the gang injunction has been a tremendous tool. We do have a collaborative effort with Duarte called DAMAGE. It's Duarte and Monrovia Anti-Gang Enforcement. And that has had some sporadic participation over the last couple years. But that's not gone away. Our team's still there if we want to put those out. And then we have our special enforcement team that works gangs and narcotics. So there's been nothing, though, that's been removed because of resources
okay.
gone.
Thank you.
Any questions for the chief? I have one. So I know that there are thousands of more criminals that are set to be released into our streets here shortly, thanks to Sacramento. And I know our crime is going up. What would you tell the average person who's sitting at home tonight watching this? what can they do to try to remain safer?
Well, always what's been the most effective tool at all times for us, and what's really been the impact in this community, is neighbors watching out for neighbors. That's been our program since the late 80s, is to get folks to work together to look out for each other. That's the basis of the MAP program. It's the basis of Neighborhood Watch. And so knowing your neighbors, looking out for each other, not being afraid to call when you see something suspicious. Nearly every crime that we solve isn't because officers are out there making great observations. It's because somebody calls us because something is suspicious. The officers get there quickly and take action. And so that's the greatest tool that we have to protect each other, is just knowing each other and looking out for each other.
See something, say something.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Chief, I'm sorry to hit you with this on the spot, but if you could give viewers just an overview of Prop 47, 57, and AB 109, some people may not be familiar with what those are and what impact they've had.
Yeah, I'd be happy to. Assembly Bill 109 was basically changing a number of felonies the way they were processed and giving them to local control. So felonies that used to be served in state prison are now served in county jail. And they put all of the burden for monitoring these folks and keeping them in jail on the county, which...
So do you know if the county was prepared to deal with that before the burden was placed on them, or was it just sort of precipitously placed on them?
It was just dumped on them. And for us, it hit L.A. County worst, because when you look at the population in the state, one-third of the population is right here in Los Angeles County. And so L.A. County probation, L.A. County jails were not prepared to handle the impact that all of those changed felonies that were now going to serve their time in a county jail, that was just something they weren't ready for. Jails aren't made to house prisoners for 3, 4, 5 years. They're meant to house people until they go to prison. So that was a huge burden on the LA County jail system. And then probation was the ones that were going to be responsible for monitoring these people after they're released. So it used to be state parole would monitor them for 2 to 3 years. Now they changed it. It was going to be probation for 6 to 12 months. And they simply weren't prepared. Probation doesn't go out in the field. Most of their officers are not armed, and so nobody was watching them. That's why local police had the burden to monitor these folks, and we created a team here regionally to deal with that. We had asked for funding from the state, and they gave it to us for a period of time, but they took that away 2 years ago. So there's currently only probation supposedly monitoring these folks, and yet on a couple of these cases, nobody's really tracking them. So Prop 47 then...
Sure. Before we move on from AB 109, can you tell us what the impetus behind AB 109 was? Why did the Assembly decide to dump these state prisoners into the county jails, which of course had the impact of reducing space in county jails and not making space for, you know, misdemeanors and that sort of thing?
Yeah, the whole impetus is the Supreme Court decision, because prisoners in the state of California were not getting the care that they felt they were supposed to in terms of medical attention because of the overcrowding in the jail. So the Supreme Court said, hey, you got to reduce your population or build facilities to house them. And so the state was looking for ways to reduce the population. Cal chiefs and all the law enforcement agencies tried to work with them to make a plan. Ultimately, AB 109 just said, hey, these certain types of crimes, we're going to reduce them and serve them at the county level. And they were also going to release the other ones earlier under those terms that were already in prison. But what they never took into effect was, you know, somebody might be in there for burglary, like this, some of these individuals we talked about, but their criminal history could have been assault with a deadly weapon, attempted murder, any number of violent crimes. And so they never took that into effect. It was just whatever the charge was that they were in there for. So when they said to the public that they were going to release nonviolent criminals, that was never true. It was just they weren't in for a nonviolent offense.
So their last offense happened to be nonviolence?
Yes.
So do you know if there's a movement afoot at any level amongst any people to fund more prisons or greater capacity so that we can take them off the street and put them back in prison where they belong?
Well, there was prior to AB 109. There were some attempts to utilize prisons in other states. That was really knocked down because the union didn't want to lose those jobs here in California, and so you know, our elected officials chose not to go that route. And so it ultimately ended up where the state was just trying to find ways to reduce the prison population.
When you say union, you're talking about the Correction Officers Union?
Yes. Okay. So then Prop 47 changed a whole number of crimes from felonies to misdemeanors, most significantly all the drug offenses for possession were changed to misdemeanors. So you have what it used to be in the state was that if you were convicted of possession of a serious drug, cocaine, heroin, methamphetamine, many others, that you would have a felony that you were facing. And we had a proposition that allowed them to have no crime whatsoever on their record if they went into rehabilitation. So what they've done now is decriminalized all of those drugs in some ways by making them misdemeanors, but what they did is took away the incentive for any of them to go to rehab. So what we're seeing now is when you see folks, you know, many more folks in our community that are homeless, many of them were released from prison and didn't have a place to go, and if they're substance abusers, they'll find ways to get those substances, and all we can do is arrest them, book them, write them a ticket, and let them out. And so it's fairly difficult when people want to know why aren't we doing some things about folks in our community. It's once again, it's like a revolving door. They're in and they're out. Mm-hmm. And because those are misdemeanors, the jail's full of felons now that were given to us by the state. There's not much room for the misdemeanor cases. So many of them are getting out on probation, parole, these bracelet things, a whole host of things.
So did it used to be the case, and I don't know if it was Prop 47 that changed this, but my understanding is that it used to be the case that a serial criminal who committed a series of misdemeanors would eventually be charged with a felony for what would have been a misdemeanor if he didn't have a long history of committing misdemeanors, and that now that's changed. Now there's no cumulative effect that results in a felony charge.
Yeah, that's mixed. Prop 47 did some of that, and Prop 57 finished it off. Yeah. So Prop 47 changed petty theft, where it used to be anything under $500. They changed it to $950. Mm-hmm. And then what they did away with was petty theft with a prior. Mm-hmm. So you can now steal $949 10 times a day. You're only going to get a misdemeanor every time. There's no cumulative effect. It never turns into a felony. Mm-hmm. And so then Prop 57 comes along, and it takes and changes even violent crimes because they didn't explain the definition of it. So crimes like this guy in Covina, who did an assault with a deadly weapon, let's talk about our case in Monrovia, who did an assault with a deadly weapon, attempt murder. He could do 3-4 crimes on that particular case, but when you look at the time he's going to get released, they only look at the primary offense, and he'll only serve that time, and generally only half of it. And then Prop 57 made it where he could get out even earlier if, let's say, he goes to high school classes or college classes while he's in jail. And so that's why you see a guy that did an attempt murder out in 9 months. Yeah. So Prop 57 dealt with a lot of that. It wiped out all of our victims' rights laws because you could have a first-time burglar and he'll get an X amount of time. You can have another burglar that's done 10 cases, but it's still, you know, when you look at the parole release time, they're only going to look at the primary offense. So he'll get out just as early as the first-time offender.
Chief, I read that there was a bipartisan attempt in Sacramento mm-hmm. to change the legal definition of all rapes to be legally violent crimes, because, as you know, a lot of them are not considered to be that under Prop 57 in the Penal Code. And my understanding is the Public Safety Committee in Sacramento rejected that. So what I really don't understand is I don't hear any outrage amongst women's groups when you see that rape is still considered to be a lower-level crime in many instances. And have you heard anything new on that?
I haven't heard anything new on that. Yeah. It's just, it's like the thing with the guns, you know. Most handguns are under $950, so we put through a bill to make theft of a handgun a felony, and Governor Brown vetoed it, so it didn't go through. So, I mean, these are the challenges we're facing in the state. What's frustrating for us as law enforcement, because we deal with victims, is no one seems to care about the victims. They're all acting as if the suspects are the victims. And so it's very challenging times in our state. Prop 47 and Prop 57 changed our Constitution. So to move it back will be a challenge.
Yeah, it's constitutional changes are tough. But well, I hope more people are listening at home. So if you know why crime is on the rise, at least you'll understand why and try to keep an eye on your neighbors and help each other out.
But I think it's also important that people understand that if enough of us contact our state assembly member or our state senator and pound their offices with phone calls or their websites with email addresses, that sooner or later, that's what makes the pendulum swing back is the outrage. And so I'm thinking maybe on our website we ought to make sure that we've got readily available for people on a link so that they can just be directed to it and express that outrage to the people that can do something about this.
Chief, thank you so much. We appreciate the update. Thank you. Anything else, Oliver?
That'll be it, Mr. Adams.
Okay, we'll move on to number two, CIP and grants update. Brittany Mello, Senior Management Analyst. And that senior part is not like with me. you get the dog, I'll pay for it.
Well, good evening, City Council members. I'm thrilled to be here tonight to present the next quarterly update in our series for our capital improvement projects and our grant projects. I'll wait for the PowerPoint to get loaded. All right, so our first project is Monrovia Renewal. As you know, this is a five-year campaign to improve the infrastructure in our water system, sewer system, and streets. I'm happy to report that our Southwest segment, our first segment in the project, is nearly complete. So we only have left to do the street striping, and that will be occurring in March. And then we have, for our southeast section, we have began the concrete work. So those are improvements to our curbs, gutters, and driveway approaches. And then the sidewalk improvements are also underway. And in mid-March, the road work itself, the improvements to the street surface, will begin. So residents living on streets that whose streets need to be completely pulverized or rehabilitated, they'll see those improvements first, and then the other residents will see. So please be on the lookout. If you're east of Myrtle Avenue between Colorado Boulevard and the 210, those improvements will be coming your way shortly. We also are in the process of designing and engineering phase two. So that's our northwest segment, which is everything west of Myrtle Avenue between Colorado and Hillcrest, as well as everything south of the 210 freeway. So that engineering is underway, and that will be taking place starting next year after these segments have been completed. And tonight we're anticipating awarding improvements for the sidewalk repairs in all of the remaining segments of Monrovia Renewal, which Mr. Sullivan will be presenting on later this evening. For well number 4, which is one of the wells in our water utility system, that received a total rehabilitation earlier in the late last year. And through the SoCal Edison, they have a cash incentive program to give us a rebate based on the energy efficiency improvements that we achieved through that rehabilitation process. So I'm happy to report that we received nearly $56,000 for the rebate, and that's because we were able to improve the energy efficiency of the pump in that well by 18%. In addition to that one-time rebate amount, we will be saving approximately $21,000 each year running that pump from our prior energy costs for that. So it's very exciting savings in that. Additionally, the rehabilitation meant that we were able to pump much more water per minute. So we went from about 1,700 gallons per minute to 2,600 gallons per minute. So this is a huge improvement in our ability to pump water from our groundwater basin into our water system.
Brittany, do you recall what that cost?
The total amount, I did not have the final amount.
I'm just trying to think what the payback is.
It was about $150,000.
We spent $150,000.
But we got $55,000 back.
And we got a $55,000 rebate, and we're saving $21,000 a year. So in 5 years, it's a wash. Good job.
No, it's a great work from our Water and Public Works Division. I also have some pictures, because who doesn't love pictures? So here we have our contractor, General Pump, installing the column down into the well, which is like a big straw that spins and pumps the water through. And you see about 250 feet of pipe that was attached to that straw, as well as the motor on the lower right-hand corner that was rebuilt and will serve us well for probably 50 years was what our Water System Division Manager was estimating. So very exciting improvements. Our next project is our Huntington Drive median upgrade. So if you've driven along Huntington Drive recently, you've probably seen that the middle median is not as beautiful as it could be because it looks brown as you're seeing on the right. There you also see some new piping and irrigation being laid. So that this project was awarded for approximately $1 million. And the construction began in late January, and it will be continuing over the next couple of months and hopefully will be completed in April. We do have some pictures of what the plant palette will look like. So our landscape designer recommended this Mediterranean-style landscape palette that was adopted, and so you see a variety of shrubs, ground cover, and succulents. Yes.
I was just curious, how many of the liquid amber trees are going to be removed? None of them? Because I know that some of them weren't in the greatest shape. Okay.
Mm-hmm. I do know some new trees, as you can see, will be planted along with the shrubbery. So it should be a very welcoming median for drivers going through Monrovia, and hopefully they'll turn down and shop and eat in our town. And there's a second before and after picture. Next, we have the Julian Fisher Park renovation. So this is for a variety of improvements at Julian Fisher Park, including to the basketball court, the lighting, the landscaping, as well as the monument sign, and adding a public restroom at the park. So right now, the landscape design is nearly complete. The monument sign design is complete, and staff is working to finalize the notice inviting bids that will be opening next month for hopefully to award a contract to our consultant in April and begin construction in May, with the goal of making these improvements to our park by the end of summer 2017. Next, we have the park master plan. This is where staff is working with our consultant Conservation Techniques to gather information from the community on really what they want to see in the future of our parks in Monrovia. Do we need more park space? What improvements should we make to our current park space, our amenities, and kind of where those gaps exist? So our consultant gave us a nice Valentine's Day present and did some stakeholder interviews with some key folks on Valentine's Day, as well as met with the Community Services Commission to gather their input. And coming up this week, or by early next week, there will be a survey being mailed out to about 2,500 random residents in Monrovia, asking them to participate and provide their input for the park master plan. And these were randomly selected so that we can find out really what statistically significant findings that our residents really want versus maybe only hearing from one group of folks and not being sure if that was really representative of what the community was looking for. And then there will also be an online survey open for everyone who would like to provide their input. And so you can look for that link coming up next week, as well as on our website and then the city manager's update. And for next steps, there will be a community meeting held on April 13th at the Community Center. So we invite you and everyone who loves Monrovia's parks to come and talk to us, or maybe those folks who don't love the parks and want to make sure that we can make those improvements. Next, we have the Recreation Park baseball field upgrade. So this was to improve the field at Recreation Park. So this is a picture of the newly laser leveled and repaired field that was able to thankfully be repaired before opening day for the Monrovia Youth Baseball League. So staff had met with the baseball league to really gather their input, assess the needs, and ensure that that field was in top playing condition for our community. Staff is also looking for some grant opportunities to make some more improvements to that field, and then we will be working with as we develop the park master plan to really make the needed improvements as they're needed, but also be thoughtful of the resources that we're putting into it and coordinating that with the park master plan recommendations. We're also conducting the community center planning to see what improvements we need to make at the community center to better serve the community in terms of the facility itself. So right now there is a community survey underway that's gathered about 125 responses. So that's great so far, and we're really hoping to get as much input as possible. So you can see the link there to go fill that out. It's a short survey, it won't take you long, and it can really make a big impact in the community. That survey will be open until next month, and then those results will be presented to the Community Services Commission to gather their feedback as well and determine next steps. For the library strategic plan, this is to determine really the future of the Monrovia Public Library and what improvements would really be best for the community. And so we conducted a survey earlier, and that received 300 responses. So that was a great turnout from the community. So thank you for everyone who participated. And currently, the consultant, Jennifer Sweeney and Associates, is working with staff to develop some SMART goals that can be used to improve the library, and working to finalize the strategic plan itself. And once that is prepared, we'll be presenting to the library board as well as the city council. Next, we have Track-It permitting system. And I know we had our community development staff introduced earlier, and I know really everyone in that department is working hard to implement the integrated permitting system. It's about a year-long process to get all of the workflow processes into that database, to make it so staff can really use that as an effective tool for the community, as well as the community who's coming to the public-facing portals to be able to gather information. In just last city council meeting, the city council approved a contract with the city of Rancho Cucamonga's GIS services, and that one of the items in their scope of work will be to improve the GeoTrack module as well as the entire Track-It system, so that people can go to a location, hopefully click on a parcel and find the information they need all in one spot. So it'll really be helpful for folks looking to gather that information. And this hopefully will be launching by the end of 2017, probably around October or November. We're also in the middle of a website redesign process with our consultant Vision Internet. So this We're happy to report that staff is currently being trained. We went through a writing for the web training. You know, you might want to write every fact you have about a topic, but maybe that's not as user-friendly. So we learned from the experts really how much information to present, what kind of tone to use to help people be engaged. So we went through that process with about 40 staff just a couple of weeks ago. And then we have another training next week to learn how to use the tool itself. We're really trying to empower all of the staff to be able to make these updates so that we're providing information in a user-friendly way and in a timely way for the community. So we're hoping to be able to launch the website in early April, so not too far from now. So with that, as you can see, staff has been very busy this last quarter, and as you can see, about 8 projects that were completed since the last update. And since we started tracking the CEP and grant projects in the summer of 2015, staff has completed 25 projects. So that's something that we can be proud that our resources are going back to the community through these improvements. And we also have about 56 projects underway and being tracked. And of course, who doesn't like pictures of the completed projects? So this is the crosswalk at Mountain Avenue that connects the BMW dealership to the Best Buy shopping center. And we installed new pedestrian crosswalks, you can see on both sides, and pedestrian countdown heads that will make it safer for people to walk. I know I personally saw many jaywalkers running across from the BMW, so this will make it much safer for pedestrians and drivers.
And Council Member Liz Riley from Duarte, since this is right on the border, wanted to say a great big thank you for this, because some of her constituents were the ones you saw scurrying across trying to dodge traffic.
Absolutely. Here we have a few more projects that were completed since the last update, which include the Blue Star Banner program that was up in time for Veterans Day, as well as the new roof at Fire Station 103, which is that access point to our Hillside Wilderness Preserve. And we have a police department office renovation, and that, you know, might just look like a normal office, but before then it was a generator room with a big piece of ugly equipment and ventilators on the walls, and that was just used for storage. So it wasn't a very functional space, and now it's a beautiful office for the Community Policing Bureau to work out of. And finally, we have the well field valve replacement. So down at the city's well field, we replaced about 6 valves, and that allows the water system division to turn off and limit where water is flowing to be able to make repairs and maintenance in an effective manner. So that'll really help our operational system. And then finally, we have the Santa Fe Middle School bioswell upgrade. So you can see here the new plants in that bioswell that will help collect water, which is what it's there for, so in a beautiful manner.
And I'm so glad that we got the school board to agree that there was a purpose for this. So
absolutely. So with that, I'm happy to answer any questions.
Any questions for Brittany?
Great report.
Thank you. Nice report. And just remember, everyone, you can get the renewal updates online as well for all the information, all the great things we're doing.
I do have one, Brittany, and I know that we've had a lot of rain delays on some of our work, and when you're in a drought, it's hard to complain about the rain delays, but I see you're getting close to completion. I see some of the streets you're getting ready for striping. When you go to get that first street that's completely redone from the dirt up, mm-hmm. can you let us know?
Absolutely.
Because to me, that's kind of an exciting time. We've got $52 million worth of work coming, but that first victory, I think, will be pretty exciting.
Absolutely.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Okay, now we'll move on to reports of city council members and subcommittees. Council Member Spicer.
I have no report, Mayor.
Thank you, sir. Council Member Shevlin.
Yes, thank you. I did want to report back our last council meeting. I brought it before you from the San Gabriel Valley Council of Governments. They brought before the governing board the quarter-cent sales tax measure, Measure H, the Los Angeles County, which is the only measure on a ballot in Monrovia for March 7th, not to be confused with our April 11th ballot. But at any rate, we as a council decided to take a no position. And at the COG meeting this last week, it was debated, and it ended up with 11 yes, 1 no, and 8 abstentions. So the ayes have it, and they voted to support Measure H. So if you see anything in publications that the COG is supporting it, that I just wanted to come back to you with that. Also, the ACE Construction Authority, that's the Alameda Quarter East Construction Authority, which has done the grade separations, and ACE was formed by the COG. They will, in the next few years, be running out of, I mean, their mission will have been fulfilled. And it's a question as to whether or not COG wants to continue on with that construction authority, and the governing board gave them the okay to look further into it, do more research, and they're going to come back with a report in about 6 months. In the meantime, though, they are, and I believe they've already actually applied for it, monies through Measure M to hire a transportation consultant, which would address needs not just of the COG, but member cities as well regarding transportation issues in your cities. And so I'll have more information about the actual duties of that person, but it's covered by Measure M dollars. And then on Foothill Transit, I on Friday attended the Foothill Transit Governing Board, and they are looking into fare restructuring. Public transportation, especially bus service, is highly sustained by public dollars. And there's very little that the fare recovery is actually pretty low. But they have lost quite a bit of money of late for various reasons, increase in wages, operating costs, and things like that. So they're going to be looking at fare restructuring, and I'll bring back information on that as well. There will be public meetings that people can give their input on that. Wanted to mention that Monrovia Reads, all the great things that Monrovia does, but one of the organizations is Monrovia Reads, a local literacy nonprofit. And again, their big event is coming up Thursday, March 2nd, and we are going to have some great offerings in terms of auction items from the police department, the fire department, lots of other goodies and things to bid on, and especially Chief Hunt is going to have his
pizza.
No, not he. We're going to have a few other things, a gun training package, and some the virtual training thing. Some really good things in the and the fire
department. Not real guns, virtual guns.
No, that a gun, a real gun.
Real gun.
A training session.
Oh,
so
if I can chime in just for a second.
Uh huh.
That's actually my idea. For Rotary, when I was, I don't know if I was president or coming up on the presidency, I was looking for auction items. And so I approached I think it was Chief Hunt about that, and we came up with this idea. And I think Rich Tipping bought it for like $800 the first year it was auctioned off, and it's been very popular since
then. We had it last year at our event, so
somebody that had too much money.
It goes to a wonderful cause, literacy, reading.
I was talking about the Rotary thing.
Oh. Okay.
You know why, you know, Fred Bowden was on the line bidding against Rich Tipping at the time. So he's putting a little pressure.
Well, I hope you all come out and do a lot of bidding at the Monrovia Reads event. It will be an awesome evening. We have lots of things to offer, and it's always a very fun night. It is, again, Thursday, March 2nd at 6 p.m. at the Doubletree Hotel. If anyone is interested, you can contact Diane Domitoff here at the city, 303-6600. Or you can go to our website, which is monroviareads.org. And if you can't come to the event, you can always, we'll take money.
Okay.
And we're gonna have some nice Dodger tickets, too, that our city attorney is going to be donating for the event. So
who's going to donate?
Our city attorney. So lots of great things. So I hope you can come out and support the event. It is really a lot of fun. I did want to thank staff in all the rains and everything. I know they were really, really, really busy, and it goes to that see something, say something. And there was a tree in our street that's always been kind of leaning. But the other day I noticed it was really leaning, and with all the rains and whatnot that we've gotten. And it was on Saturday or Sunday, and I sent a text, and they got right out there, and it was dangerous, and they took it out. And I want to say thank you. Thank you for being so responsive. And again, I can't say enough about go online, get those city manager update reports and the our renewal projects. You can get all that information online. It's all there for the reading. So just go on the website. And happy birthday,
Mayor.
Thank
you, Becky.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Councilmember Crudgington.
Just one quick thing. The Upper San Gabriel Valley Municipal Water District is offering turf removal classes. Learn to convert your lawn into a drought-tolerant landscape. I know it's raining a lot now, but it will be hot and dry again real soon. They're going to have a class in English on February 28th, in Spanish on March 2nd, and in Mandarin on March 8th. And you can find out more about that at www.upperdistrict.org. And that's it for me.
Thank you, Gloria. Mayor Pro Tem Blackburn.
Thank you. I had intended to speak on one thing, but after the chief's presentation, I decided to go back to Prop 57, Prop 47, and AB 109. I think it's, I don't think it's something we just want to talk about and then move on from. And I think that Councilwoman Crudgington had an excellent point when she said, you know, what we can do is put some pressure on our state legislators, both our assemblyman and our senator, and let them know that, hey, you know, these three laws are a problem and we want it changed. And so, of course, individuals can do that, but I think that we as a city should also do something similar. I think we should find out what our assemblyman's position on it was, on these three laws, what our state senator's position on these three laws was, and if they supported any of these three, I think I'd like to invite them to come and defend that position. So I'm sure their position on this is a matter of record. I think I saw our senator send out an endorsement in 57, so I'd like to see him come and defend that position.
I think that is an excellent idea. The thing that just baffles me to no end is that that the rape of an unconscious person in the state of California is not legally a violent action.
And I'd like to hear our representatives and our senators' explanation for why they believe the rape of an unconscious woman is not a violent crime.
Right. I suspect if they were a victim of it, they may have a different opinion.
Well, you shouldn't even have to be a victim of
it. What's amazing to me is that a group of men in Sacramento turned down changing that to a violent crime when a group of female legislators requested it. And yet there's seemingly no outrage over that. I just don't understand it, but I think that's a great idea, and perhaps we could send those invitations out.
We can certainly go ahead and coordinate that that response. I think part of the challenge with Prop 47, Prop 57, again, it's the way that both of those pieces of legislation were marketed. Over 60% support, both went to the ballot. There was over 60% support for both of those throughout the state, right. And Monrovia, similar numbers. And Monrovia right. voted for those measures.
Right.
And I think the concept of doing additional education, outreach, and, again, corresponding with our state legislators makes a lot of sense.
Sure.
At this point, the feedback when we've had informal discussions, the entire push has been to try to get additional folks out of the prison system. Reducing prison headcount right now is kind of the key priority, and it's driving a lot of these changes, but there are going to be far-reaching consequences, and I think Councilmember Crudgington mentioned earlier that outrage. At some point, we're going to create so many victims that there's going to be a demand for change.
And right, and it's predictable.
Absolutely.
It's predictable.
And I think starting that discussion now makes a lot of sense.
Of course.
And including in it the fact that these propositions are entitled Safe Streets or Safe Cities, right. when the net effect of what happens is the exact opposite of it.
Well, and reporting statistics, because if you've reduced the crime and whatnot, you can then tout statistics that appear to be lower.
Oh, but absolutely. If you felonies applied, are down.
Right.
Yeah, well,
yeah,
it's
right,
easy
right,
to say we
right.
don't have any crime right. if nobody's a criminal.
Right. right. And the same thing within and drug rehabilitation and things like that. So they appear to be skewed.
Right. At this point, the challenge in Sacramento right now is that there's a large majority, a very strong majority of Sacramento really believes these are the right policy decisions to make. In fact, we've had lots of discussions with the chief. Chief Hunt's mentioned on occasions, California Police Chiefs Association met with Governor Brown's legislative team prior to Prop 57 going on the ballot, made some very sensible requests to modify some portions and provisions of Prop 57 before advancing the measure. And the response that the police chiefs got back from the governor's office was basically, I've got more money than you. I'm going to put this forward, and right. good luck to you.
Right. So he won the marketing job initially. Mm-hmm. But right. now there's going to be a lot of backlash, or there should be, as people become victims of crimes. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, some of those violent crimes are going to be categorized as nonviolent. And so when crime is reported, the governor and his supporters and other fools who supported this will be able to say, oh, look, violent crime is down. Mm-hmm. So there's going to have to be a little asterisk next to that statistic that explains, yes, violent crimes are down because we've now categorized violent crimes as nonviolent
right.
crimes.
Well, there's going to be 5 funerals next week
right.
from people that, had it not been for early release, would not be dead today.
Right. And even in the midst of some of those changes, crime is up across the state. California State Attorney General last year released a report that 2014 compared with 2015 saw a 10% increase statewide in crime. What we're absolutely confident of is the report this year will show even higher percentage increases. As the chief and I discuss public safety issues each week, what we hear from all of our counterparts in neighboring cities is 20 to 30 to 40% increases in Part 1 crimes is very typical and very common right now, and we're seeing that all through L.A. County. So I think that's part of the reason why the suggestion from the council tonight to be more aggressive in reaching out to our state legislators on this issue makes a lot of sense, and we'll certainly add this to our work plan.
And could you describe that? You said Part 1 crimes, just so everyone knows what we're talking
certainly.
About.
Part 1 crimes are the cachet of crimes that the FBI has identified as the most prevalent types of criminal activities. Right. They include the most serious types of crimes that we track, including burglaries, murders, rapes, larceny, theft. There's a whole cachet of what constitutes a Part 1 crime. There's really, again, it's the indicator that we all use, every jurisdiction uses, to measure crime. And our police chief can certainly give a much more succinct answer if there's more details.
Well, and it'll be interesting to have our two, I believe both of our legislators in Sacramento are male.
Yes.
To have them come explain to us why letting rapists out on the street earlier is okay. I'd just like to have them explain why they think it's okay.
I'd also like to know, to the extent that we stopped housing prisoners out of state, which would have prevented them perhaps from being released onto the streets, why that was stopped out of consideration for the Correction Officers Union, and why their union considerations trumped public safety considerations. Mm-hmm. I would like to know that as well.
Certainly. Yeah. Now, I think this is a lot of the issues, as we've talked about it internally, it just doesn't make a lot of sense that, there's a lot of talk right now from folks that are saying, well, crime may be up, but compared with, the last 20 years, it's still not that high. The point is, though, that every year that passes, more and more victims are being created, and law enforcement believes very strongly. There's no one I've spoken with in law enforcement that doesn't believe that collectively AB 109, Prop 47, Prop 57, that those three measures changing our criminal justice system in California, that's really what's been swinging the conversation away, or swinging the facts away from having, we had an incredibly safe state. We had, historic lows in crime. And as we've made these changes, all of that seems to be being undone. And it is a challenging situation, but I think the suggestions the council has tonight, those are terrific. It's a terrific place to start.
Well, and I think for all of the people who say that crime used to be worse than it is now, and that we're really at I guess what they're saying is an acceptable level. They should go to the funeral of the Whittier police officer and explain that to his family, because this is just not acceptable at any level. I just, they have a tough enough job without this. Thank you. Okay, and last but not least, my report is going to be very brief. So the city of Monrovia has a 1917 Seagrave fire engine that started its life in Monrovia in 1917 and at some point moved on elsewhere. Susan Motander discovered it, found it, bought it, donated it back to the city, and people have spent, I think, in excess of $200,000 on it so far, yet it's not drivable. And it's not drivable because it needs a new clutch. Now, the Monrovia Day Parade coming up in May will be its 100th birthday. And so I started a GoFundMe account today to see if we can get people to do donations. And anyone can donate, Craig. I see that look on your face, kind of like, how? So if you go to GoFundMe.com, and you can find it either under the City of Monrovia, 1917 Seagrave Fire Engine, and we're going to try to raise enough money to get that running so we can drive it in the parade in May and maybe raise enough money to finish it. So if you have a few extra dollars and you want to kind of help out on history, go to GoFundMe.com, find the Monrovia 1917 Seagrave Fire Engine, and slip us a few bucks. We've got a few donations that came in today. This just started this afternoon. It doesn't have to be big. $5, $10, $100, whatever you may have. And hopefully we'll get that running and in the parade in May. And we appreciate everyone's support. Okay, now we will move on to administrative reports. AR1, reauthorizing and readopting the city's public educational and governmental access support. And Mr. Steele will give us that report.
Thank you, Mr. Adams, Mayor, and members of the City Council. In keeping with our theme this evening of dumb stuff that the state legislature has imposed on us, in 2006, the state legislature decided that despite a well-working system of local franchises for cable television and other video-type source systems in the state being granted on a local basis, the state legislature decided that the state was better suited to grant those franchises on a statewide basis. And so mostly at the insistence of the telecommunications and cable television companies, the Public Utilities Commission took over regulation of local franchises, and we had no longer had control of those activities in our community, even though the cables and wires are using city streets. So in 2007, the first 10-year statewide franchises were issued, and as part of that law creating this statewide system, the local jurisdictions were permitted to continue to impose a public access education fee. We called them PEG fees, to fund the local public education and government channels. Here would be the KGEM operation. We were permitted to continue to collect those fees, 1% of the charges in any given city. However, they were imposed to coexist with the term of the franchise, and at the end of the franchise, in order to keep collecting the fee, that ordinance must be reauthorized and readopted. In Monrovia, the first state franchise expires on March 30th. That's the AT&T franchise, which I understand is a relatively small piece of the $48,000 or $49,000 in revenue that this fee generates, but it is the first one to expire. And so under everybody's reading of this law for the first time, we think that the PEG fee needs to be readopted and reauthorized before that first one expires in order to keep having that fee collected by the operators and remitted to the city and keep that source of revenue coming in. So staff is recommending that the council introduce and read by title only, waive further reading of the ordinance that's presented to you. It makes no change to the existing municipal code. It just simply reauthorizes the collection of that fee for another period of time.
Any questions for Mr. Steele?
I'm just curious about the anticipated revenue as we go forward.
Buffy gave me a number of about $48,000 a year, and it would be roughly about the same.
So it's just going to be about the same. Thanks.
Any other questions? We'll entertain a motion.
So moved.
Second.
The motion is to introduce, waive further reading, and read by title only, ordinance number 2017-02. Any objection to that? Hearing none, that will be approved, and would you please read it?
Thank you. Ordinance number 2017-02, an ordinance of the City of Monrovia, California, reauthorizing and readopting the city's public, educational, and governmental access support fee.
Thank you, sir. AR2, consultant services agreement with Precision Concrete Cutting, and Sean Sullivan, our Public Works Division Manager, will give that report. Welcome, Sean.
Thank you. Good evening, Mr. Adams and members of the council. As Brittany updated in a report of the capital projects going on within the city, Monrovia Renewal is well underway. While Monrovia Renewal focuses on the water, sewer, and street infrastructure within the city, the sidewalk reconstruction and repair is a large component of what we're doing. As a component of the design for Monrovia Renewal, the city contracted with Precision Concrete Cutting to conduct a comprehensive inventory of sidewalk throughout the city. Precision Concrete Cutting was selected as they're a partner of the California JPIA, which is our city's risk management provider, and that they have a specialize in trip hazard removal. They use a patented diamond cutting technique where they cut the trip hazards out of the sidewalk rather than removing and replacing them. Ultimately, what you end up with is a ADA compliant smooth finish on the sidewalk at a cost that's substantially lower than replacing the concrete sidewalk. Precision Concrete Cutting has completed the assessment of approximately 130 miles of sidewalk throughout the city. Additionally, they've been well at work for the last several months making the recommended cuts in the southwest and southeast area of the Monrovia Renewal Project. At this point, staff is very satisfied with their work, both with the cutting and with the comprehensive report, and feels it's a viable asset for activities under Monrovia Renewal. Recently, Precision Concrete Cutting completed the remaining survey of the remaining areas, which would be the north, northwest, northeast, and south segments of the city, all of the remaining areas of Monrovia Renewal. Through that survey, they identified an additional 419,000 square feet of sidewalk that are in neither need of repair or replacement. Assessing the sidewalk for the lift of the raise and the overall condition of it, they identified that approximately 250,000 square feet of that sidewalk could be saved utilizing their cutting method. The cost savings of using their cutting method over replacement of the 260,000 square feet would be tremendous. The cost to do the cutting as prescribed by Precision, as they've done in the previous areas, would be about $413,000. Using a general engineer's estimate of $10 per square foot, the cost to remove and replace 260,000 square feet of sidewalk would be about $2.6 million. That being the case, Precision Concrete Cutting's cost works out to about $1.65 a square foot, or about 16% the cost of removal and replacement. Like I said, staff is pleased with the work they've done thus far on the finished product on the concrete sidewalk, and we believe that this substantial cost savings is viable to achieving all of the work that needs to be done under Monrovia Renewal and resulting in a nice finished product with the sidewalk throughout the city. Upon approval of this agreement, Precision Concrete Cutting will continue to work through the city as they're continuing to finish up work in the southwest and southeast area. They've guaranteed that they'll leave their crews mobilized to continue working. And they anticipate that there would be about 6 to 8 months worth of work left to complete the entire city for the concrete cutting. Now, that being said, that they can save about 260,000 square feet of that sidewalk, that does leave about 159,000 square feet that would need to be removed or replaced. That's beyond what Precision can save by cutting it. Of that work, about 115,000 square feet of that falls within the Monrovia Renewal Project area, and that work will be undertaken as part of the projects when they get to the specific project areas. That would leave about 44,000 square feet that's not covered in renewal. Staff is assessing that data and working on the development of a project to remove and replace that concrete as a supplemental capital improvement project, since it's not on Monrovia Renewal-related streets. That being the case, this evening, staff is requesting approval of the agreement with Precision Concrete Cutting to continue their sidewalk work throughout the city. The total cost for their services is about $475,000. Additionally, we're requesting a task order with Merrill Johnson Companies in the amount of 10% to cover the project inspection and engineering of this project. That concludes my report, and I'm happy to answer any questions.
questions.
I do have a quick question. In making their assessment, and I've seen their work, it's really good, but and it makes a nice clean cut. But do they also take in consideration tree roots? Because although they can cut it and make it nice and flat, that tree continues to grow and continues to live. So if the concrete is not removed and the root remediated, you've got the same problem in a short period of time.
Correct. They do look at all of that. Ultimately, they can cut the sidewalk up to about 2 inches of depth. So the standard sidewalk's about 4 inches. So although the tree roots will continue to grow, they believe that by cutting it smooth, we maintain some of the integrity of the sidewalk there. And ultimately, as we go through our assessment, the areas with the most tree roots, we certainly address those at the time being. Some of them have pushed them up to the point where it's beyond repair. But we have about 9,000 trees within the city. And so part of the issue is that we'd be taking out sidewalk in the amounts of, a large volume of this work. So ultimately, we're trying to find that balance between cutting what we can to salvage it at the time when we develop plans to address it as we go.
So it's kind of a Band-Aid fix for those.
No, I wouldn't call it a Band-Aid. What I'd call it is extending the life of the original concrete that we placed. Mm-hmm. Regardless if you replace it or cut it, at some point, we expect there to continue to be a lot of trees in Monrovia. That's one of the things that makes the community really terrific is all our mature trees. By cutting instead of replacing, it just extends the life of the existing infrastructure, the existing concrete that was placed originally. At some point, we will have to come back and replace the panel, but the panel's there already, and if we can save it and get, another 5 to 10 years, it makes a lot of sense.
Thank you.
But, Oliver, if the roots are sticking up too high, the panel is automatically removed and
exactly.
The roots are cut back.
That's right.
Yeah.
Any other questions for Sean? And we'll entertain her.
No comment.
Wrong answer.
Good report.
I'm just here for the sidewalk.
Maybe we get. No, I won't say that.
A move for approval.
Thank you.
And I'll second it. This
move
is
and
a,
second
this
it.
Is a new
any other discussion?
Against it.
Any objection? Hearing no objection, that will be the order. Sean, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Unfortunately, this evening, we're going to be closing our meeting in the memory of a couple people that we've lost. One, Jose Galindo, father of police officer Alex Galindo. Chief, if you would pass on our condolences, I'd appreciate it. And the other, Melinda Steep, a long time ago Monrovia Public Library employee. I remember her name well. Melinda has passed away. So if you'd keep their families and friends in your thoughts and prayers, I know they will appreciate it. We will close this evening and see you back here on March 7th. And we hope you all have a great week. Thank you so much.